That's people dialing in on the phone when you hear the beep. That's on the phone line, not the computer line.
More people watch on the computer than on the phone?
Yes.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear.
Well, time to begin. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the virtual church. This is kind of a family affair. It's like an informal Bible study that we do every week, sitting around the coffee table or wherever you might be, and opening the Bible and thinking about your life, thinking about the scriptures and how they might relate to it, and having a vicarious fellowship with other Christians. Vicarious because they're maybe not in the room, maybe except if maybe your wife is there or some friends. But Christians are tuning in all over. My granddaughter's just asking how many. We've checked different times, but usually there's several hundred tuning in all various parts of the country and Canada and the world for that matter. And we're thankful for all those who do. And some tune in on a regular basis because they don't have a regular church they go to. And the reasons for that might be that there are none that they identify with that are close by, or maybe they're infirmed or elderly or can't get out. And so this is like a church for them. And that's a service. Well, we provide, and we're glad we're able to do that. So you're celebrating the Sabbath, you're resting, you're pausing with others of like mind. And isn't the Church of God more than a building? Well, of course, it's not even a building, is it? The word church, ecclesia, means the called out ones, the ones who are the congregation of God. And where is the membership role kept for the true church of God? That is the congregation that belongs to God, that bears his name, that has his spirit. Well, that's kept in heaven. That's where your names are written. So I don't have the roll book for that church. We have a mailing list, but hey, I'm not claiming that's the list of all Christians by any means. Hopefully it's a list of some Christians. And I hope you're among those Christians. I'm sure you are. But the invisible church of God is that group that shares God's spirit and comes together, and we're bound by that spirit. So even though we may not see one another, we do have that bond that joins us together in this family fellowship, this family Bible study we call the virtual church. Well, before we begin today, we'll ask God's blessing, as we always do, and solicit his inspiration. Shall we pray? Father, you are the Lord of the earth, the maker of mankind, the Almighty One, the great God. The scriptures call you the Lord of hosts or the Lord of armies, for you rule. You rule everything in this cosmos. You have all power, but you have all love as well. You love us. You know us as individuals. You know the details about our lives. You know our strengths. You know our weaknesses. You know our yearnings. And you're ready to help. So we thank you, Father, that we can come to you as a loving Father, knowing that at your side is our elder brother, Jesus Christ, your firstborn of the dead Son, And we thank you so much for the opportunity to be part of your glorious church. Bless us now as we study your word. Draw us close to you. Help us to take on your image, your divine nature. These things we pray and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Are you following along in the scriptures there, Megan? I haven't turned any yet. You can park it. I'm talking to my granddaughter, Megan, here. By the way, I want to thank you for, Ron and Patsy Duck for the nice comment they sent in last week. Our little granddaughter, Matea, was up here for a couple minutes at the end of the program. She likes being on TV, and so here she was, and a cute little thing. 3 years old, highly verbal, and full of energy, and always an upbeat spirit, so it's a pleasure to have her around. We've had her around now for, you know, what, going on 2 months, because our son and daughter-in-law have sold their house, and they just bought a new place, and in the in-between time, they've been staying here until they can move in. And it looks like this coming week they'll be moving in, so we won't be seeing her smiling little face every day. The ducks wrote in that little granddaughter is a real cutie for sure. Well, she really is. And we've got a couple more granddaughters here. I got Megan here and her adopted sister, Crystal, are here. And then a couple of grandsons downstairs. Well, the topic today is speaking up for those who cannot speak for themselves. They count. Turn to Proverbs 31, verse 8. Proverbs 31, verse 8. Interesting scripture by King Lemuel in the book of the Proverbs. And he says, it gives various advice and good stuff, you know, the short little bits and pieces of things. For instance, he says, give beer to those who are perishing and wine to those who are in anguish. Verse 6. Well, what's that mean? Trying to get people drunk? No, it means to ease the pain, to cause them to relax, those that are dying, comfort them. Give them a sip of wine, for crying out loud. Ease the pain. Let them drink and forget their poverty of life and remember their misery no more. Ease the pain. Today we have harsher things. We give them morphine or we give them some other kind of drug or something. And we try to ease that pain. Same general idea, but that's the advice. That's kindness, isn't it? Sure it is. It's kindness. Now, this is not a license to go out and hit the local bar, fellas, and get sloshed every night. Drown your troubles. No, these are specific needs in desperate end-of-life situations. And he's given good advice, being concerned. And here's another piece of advice. Verse 8, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. Well, who would that be? For the rights of all who are destitute. Are there a lot of people out there that are just sort of the invisible ones that can't speak for themselves? Kind of ignored, looked over? The silent minority, majority, or whatever you want to call it? Well, I think there are an awful lot of people like that. Here in a democracy, you say, well, we don't have anything like that. Well, yeah, we've got too many. It's becoming more and more so, where our freedoms and our rights are being ignored. And the privileged class has plenty of rights, gets what it wants, but the rest are kind of ignored. Who speaks up for them? Well, they're not the privileged. They don't have money. They don't have lobbyists. They don't have inns. And when you think of countries where it's ruled by dictatorships, I mean, how terrible is that? Who speaks up for these people? Well, back in those days, speak up, it says, for those who cannot speak for themselves. As if they have a need, step in and speak for that need. Take care of that need. speak up and judge fairly, defend the rights of the poor and the needy. Now it gets into the characteristics of a noble woman, the perfect wife, in the rest of Proverbs 31. So we're to defend the rights of the needy and to be concerned about them. And I think that's the right thing to do. And one thing that our government, as it was originally established, was to do precisely that. To provide a voice for the small people, not just the king, not just the king's men, you know, like it was in England, or the lords and the ladies and the upper class. You know, the big class divisions. If you were the upper class, well, then you got privileges. If you're in the lower class, heck with you, buddy. You eke out a living as best you can. You starve. Can't pay your bills, throw you in debt or prison. You don't have any connections. Who's to speak up for you? Well, nobody. Unless somebody chooses to. Well, the way our nation was established, and let's do a little rehearsing there, it was to get away from that whole idea and to fulfill this concept here in Proverbs of fairness, of treating every individual having inalienable rights. That is, every human being having rights, that they're no-count human beings. We don't think of people as don't-matter people, no-count people, you know, just number people, the mob, the masses, the invisible ones. The riffraff. That's how a lot of the elite, a lot of the demagogues, they rule and they think of the masses of the people. They treat the masses like so much fodder to be fired out of a cannon. They're not concerned about their welfare. Why should they be concerned about themselves? And a key insight to the American Revolution was not democracy per se. It was biblical religion. And this element of biblical religion here was this inalienable right. We find it in our documents. Our Declaration of Independence is full of this. The self-evident human quality that pervades our U.S. Declaration of Independence, of human rights. You're worth something. Little people, all people are worth something, and they have rights. And there is a sacred right to mankind. If we're made in God's image, well, then there's a certain sacredness to us. We're a human being is sacrosanct, set apart by God as important. Alexander Hamilton said, "The sacred rights of mankind are not to be rummaged for among old parchments or musty records." No, we're not to go digging through. Oh, let's see, are there any rights for these stupid, dumb peasants out here? No, he said, quote, "They are written as with the sunbeam, a blast of the sun, in the whole volume of human nature by the hand of divinity itself." But written by the hand of God, the light of God shining forth, and can never be erased or obscured by mortal power. That's Alexander Hamilton. I mean, that's how we felt about it. These are the people who are trying to stand up and speak for the little people. And they have rights and human rights and should be respected as such. And let's try to construct a government that allowed for that. No more class structure. No more the big government running everything. And in the book of Genesis, God declares that we were made in His image, after His likeness, and given authority to rule the earth. Now we're to rule as He wants us to rule. And if we're dealing with other people in His image, how do we treat them? Well, we treat them as fellow image bearers of the Heavenly One. That means a certain respect. And this acknowledging of God through creation, I mean, even the Gentiles, even those who don't have the Bible, have a certain concept of right and wrong. And Paul brings that out in the first chapter of Romans, this self-evident truth which the Declaration of Independence mentions. It should be self-evident that every human being has rights. And in our very construction of our government, we should be speaking up for everyone. Well, a lot of people say nowadays that, well, the founders, they were deists or they were atheistic or something else. Absolute nonsense. Nothing could be further from the truth. The founders like Jefferson, Franklin, or us were not orthodox Christians by any stretch, but they were not atheists either. They were steeped in the biblical Christian religion from childhood. And these are the values they believed in. As John Adams put it, our third president, quote, "The Bible contains the most profound philosophy, the most moral, the most perfect morality, and the most refined policy that was ever conceived upon earth." Now, that's pretty good, isn't it? "It is the most Republican book in the world." And he didn't mean a party book. Republican form of government. We are a republic, not a democracy, as we understand. It's not a pure democracy. It's a republic. Well, men like Washington and Adams and Franklin and Madison, these guys were warriors. They were farmers, statesmen, and so on. And it was important to them that we maintain this religious concern for the equality of human beings and respect for human beings. And that's been very much lost, these unalienable rights. And that's a gift, not for man. You know, government can't give you that gift. God gives it to you. Government can try to take it away from you, which they do frequently. And I think it's happening right now, even in big free governments like ours. They try to take away freedoms here and there and somewhere else. But these gifts of freedom were given by a benevolent, almighty creator. Now, the Great Seal of the United States, found on every dollar bill, it's got a Latin expression on it, Novus Ordem Seclorum, means a new order of the ages. It was an unprecedented attempt to work out a system of self-government and political freedom to recognize these unalienable rights, like we read in Proverbs, giving voice to everyone, the rights of everyone, endowed by the Creator and bestowed upon, quote, all men, unquote, not just a favored class. Now, without the fear of God and the place of the Christian religion, men become very arrogant, don't they? And the founders knew that men would become arrogant, and then that we'd have tyranny again, and men would think that they're above the law. And so we're see. It's always a battle, isn't it? It's not settled once and for all. It's dynamic. It's like, you know, you get married and you're happy, and it's the wedding day, and everything's wonderful, everything's super. It's just going to be that way every day, every day, every day. No, there are going to be trials. That marriage has to be nourished. It has to be watered. It has to be taken care of and cared for like a garden, so that it continues to produce good fruit. That just didn't happen. You know, things can go either way. It can go bad. And we've seen that, too. So, same with governments, relationships. That's why it's important to continue to walk with God and be reminded of that walk. Liberties are a gift from God. Now, when George Washington said in the second farewell address, and I like his words, he said this, "Let us with caution indulge the supposition." Now, he speaks in a little more formal language, I understand. That was his style. "With caution indulge the supposition that morality can be maintained without religion." He said, watch out. Be very cautious of this notion that somehow you can be moral without religion. Because you can't. Not as a whole nation, not as a group of people. Maybe as an individual, not as a group. This was his warning. And here in the book of Proverbs, we find the saying, well, look, if you're going to be taking care of the needs of individuals, you have to be concerned about them. Well, here in our human experiment here with the United States, we try to design a government that had more of that sympathy toward the individual. And yet we're seeing this now, that people are becoming faceless numbers, very much without a voice. As the favored class, they rule and they exploit. They get their way, they get their dispositions, and that's not good. America, Canada, the West overall has been in a crusade to eliminate the Judeo-Christian influence, the very thing that George Washington said in his final farewell. He said, don't do it. You're in trouble if you do that. But we've been trying to do that. Get God out of the public square, out of the schools, out of everything. And we say, well, hey, we don't need him. And what's the result of that? Well, people become faceless numbers without a voice. And religion, once it's forsaken, well, then tyrants take over, and the friends of tyrants. And they're the ones who get the blessings. They're the ones who get the goodies. And the rest of the people are ignored. That's what it says there in Proverbs. Hey, somebody's got to stand up and speak for them. Well, can we? How do we do that? Well, I think that's one of the things that we pray for. Pray for our brothers, sisters, for the kingdom of God. That we pray for our nation, that it retain its Christian heritage as much as possible, because that's the best salvation, the best road to peace and equality and fairness and justice that we've got a chance to get in this life. This is not the kingdom of God. The United States is not the kingdom of God, far be it, but it's the best attempt man has done to self-govern himself. So speak up for those who cannot speak up for themselves. You do that in your personal life. You see people that nobody's caring about, take notice. Speak up for them. That is for their needs, for their justice. Be kind to them. Be good. Why? Because they're made in the image of God. They have inalienable rights. Respect them and realize that God loves them. He's aware of them. And then we have the gift of God, a good God, an almighty God who's given us freedom. And we want to give that gift to everybody that we can possibly touch in life. So Proverbs 31:8 is a good axiom for guidance. It was one that I think guided our founding fathers as they were constructing a just and equitable self-government scheme, which we see now very much becoming eroded because we moved away from the Judeo-Christian foundings of it. And the results are not going to be good. But regardless of how the country goes, you are a country of one. And what you do with those that you meet, you can speak up for them and their needs by acts of kindness and acts of justice. Prayer request for Juan Rude, Noel Rude's son, who has had some physical problems. We're getting a diagnosis of what they might be. But he did fall down and passed out a while back, and something that they're trying to figure out what might be the reason for that. So be praying for him and for his wife and for his children. Be praying for the persecuted Christians. There are thousands of them around the world being persecuted right now and throughout Indonesia. One of the greatest areas of persecution is in Nigeria right now, in Africa, where it's ongoing. only about 10% of the population is Muslim, but they're burning Christian churches, killing Christians as fast as they can get away with it. I say they, the Islamics. And then many Christians are in want, have need. So you don't know who they are, maybe. You could be praying for them and for the jobless and those that are in need. A lot of things to be concerned about. Also, I want to thank you for your financial support. Here as we get out of our summer doldrums, as I call it, the summer financial ditch when we get behind. Offerings drop off, people go on vacations or whatever, and so we're trying to get back into the black, as they say. So I appreciate your gifts, those of you that have supported, and if you do benefit from the virtual church, well, then please support it. It does cost every week to have the program done live and streaming live, and all the support for it. So I know you want to have a part in that, so please do. I'm reading the book by Bill O'Reilly, Killing Jesus, which is a bestseller right now. I think Joanne's already read it. And I plan to do a review of it. I don't know if I'll do it on the program here or I'll do it in one of our publications. But overall, it's got a lot of good to recommend it. You make some mistakes. Or it has some errors in it that should be pointed out as well. But he tries to be historical in his approach, which I think is a good approach. So look forward to that. Also, some of you received the journal, which is this thing I'm holding up here right now, the News of the Churches of God. Produced by Dixon Cartwright, the editor. And this is the current edition. I draw it to your attention. The picture of the nice looking lady on the cover. This was taken on my son's boat, believe it or not, up in Lake Union during our One God conference. But there are several articles here. One is an interview of me. It's entitled Would-Be Church Reformer, that's me, recalls efforts to revise seven worldwide Church of God doctrines in 1974. Seems like old history right now, but for a lot of people, they didn't even know what was going on back in those days. I was fired for my efforts. But anyway, we go through a lot of that in this issue. So I'm sure he'd be happy to send you one of these. We have a few extra copies here. If you'd like, I could send you one or the address where you can write and get one. Also, it's a publication entitled Acts, Advocating Christ the Savior is the acronym. It's a publication of the Church of God Seventh Day out of Meridian, Idaho. One of the older Church of God groups that has developed over the years. And one thing of note with this organization is that over the last couple of years, they've been moving toward biblical Unitarianism, and the small letter U, which means the belief in one God as opposed to two gods or three gods. And this has been a pretty major thing for them. So the whole denomination has moved in that direction. And they've been writing a number of articles, good articles, about it recently. So that's some development that's taken place here of late, since many of us began a crusade in this direction many, many years ago. And it's happy to see others are moving in that direction. Well, my second topic is entitled When Image Counts. Now, image sells. I've got a couple of girls sitting in here who know a lot about image. I'm sure they're concerned about image. I was when I was a kid. And we have image selling all the time for cars, for ads, sex, status, one car ad after another. And they're always zooming down some totally empty streets, zooming through this crowded city, but the streets are all empty, and the car's absolutely clean, and the guy's handsome, and the girl's handsome, and everything's cool, well-dressed, and what's the upshot of this? Well, this car is sexy, it's cool, you've got status, it goes fast, sporty, glitzy, it has all that. So that's the image. You want that image, buy this piece of steel here. That's the message. And of course, same thing with every kind of hair product and nail product and sneakers and T-shirts and you name it. Everything's about image, putting a stamp on it or a brand on it or style on it. And of course, these image fads move in and out like the tide every 13 hours, it seems. They come and they go. I remember as a kid back in high school when they got these fluorescent socks. This was new, you know, they were kind of rayon or something. And they were glow, they call them glow socks. They didn't call them glow socks then, they were just fluorescent, but that's what they are. Bright yellows and greens and oranges and, you know. And what's that? Yeah, and I guess they're back in right now. But we'd wear these things. I never bought any. I'll tell you the truth, I never did. They were cool. They were kind of interesting to look at. But that was the fad. So if you had a little bit of money and you wanted to be part of the fad, you got that. And the other fad was, well, you wear jackets with leather sleeves on. That was another fad. And then you had a ducktail hairdo, you know, kind of long in the back and come together like a duck's rear end, a lot of grease in your hair, and then if you were one of the greasers, we call them, you wore your T-shirts and you rolled your T-shirt up so you could stick your cigarette pack in the sleeve of your T-shirt so you can look cool, you know, and so whatever it was, and people had their ideas to look cool. People want to fit in, and we fit in by following. So you want to be cool? They're all doing that. I do it. Mama, get me this. Mama, get me that. Everybody's wearing it. Everybody's doing it. I need it. I look weird. I got to have it. You know, so we have these fads. It's just kids. It's not just teenagers. Adults, too. They follow the fads, different sorts, but same thing, same idea. We want to be, if we want to be a nonconformist, some people say, well, that's my image. I'm a nonconformist. I don't want to conform. So nonconformists follow other nonconformists. They conform to other nonconformists. So you find the nonconformists all looking kind of alike. You know, if you're a nonconformist, rebellious type, well, you get the piercing, the tattoos, and the color of the weird hair, and all sort of strange things like that. And then you're a nonconformist, you know, like all the other nonconformists. So you're very much a conformist.
They call them hipsters nowadays.
Hipsters, yeah. And so we want to be something different. We want to stand out a little bit, but we conform to this crowd or that crowd, even if this crowd is different from that crowd. And even if we got to get tattoos and piercings and ugly dress, take drugs and talk filthy mouth and all that, so we can kind of be in and fit in with a particular group. And then we talk about being our own person. And that usually means taking on the image of some admired subculture somewhere that we like. That's going to be my image now. I think of this kid down the street here. I see him every couple times a week, it seems like. And I watch him over the years. But he wears one of these oilskin kind of Australian trench coats. And they go all the way down the ankle, you know. They're really long. And they got a hat on there, and they're kind of dark, like dark brown, almost black. And he wears it in the warm weather, too, you know. So he's going along with his heavy old trench coat, and he must not have a any other way to get anywhere. He just walks. But what's going on in his mind? I keep thinking, what does he think? Well, he thinks he's casting a certain look. He's casting a certain image. And that's his identity. What's his identity? Well, he thinks of himself as a dashing person. Maybe that's a silhouette he has. Maybe he saw some movie somewhere of somebody in a trench coat, and you know, he thought that was admirable, and he looked at them admiringly and said, "Boy, I want to look like that." So he thinks that's a dashing look, maybe a romantic look. And he's trudging down the road with the stupid coat on in the warm weather. You know, looking cool, man. He's cool. And what's he thinking? Everybody's looking at him saying, man, what an amazing figure. What a silhouette. What a deep person he must be. Or they think, what an idiot. I don't know what he's thinking in his mind, but it's like these guys hitchhiking along the side of the road with the guitar, you know, and you see them hanging around, you know, a lot of them bums with the guitars. Was it they're such great musicians, or is this a prop? Now they see themselves as this traveling troubadour, this traveling musician, sort of romantic figure. They're so deep and so nonconformist, and they're out there just sort of floating through the byways and all, and meeting people, and they're easygoing with the world and the spirit. They're playing a little thing, and maybe it'll pick up girls. And maybe the girls are like, boy, he's cool, or he must really be attractive, or it's a romantic image or something. Who knows what's in their mind? But it's an image that they cultivate. It's a cultivated image in their own. It's their look, their unique style. Everybody's looking for a unique style. Youth particularly are looking for identity. What is your style? You want to have one. And where do you get it? Well, you look through magazines and, you know, vampire movies, TV sitcoms. People see the way some of them dress and the way they wear the lipstick and cut their hair and the rest. And so they get that kind of lipstick and cut their hair like that. And that's kind of their image now. They fit in there, whatever it might be. And so that's where they talk like them. They mimic the expressions, mimic the hairdos and the rest, because they want to develop a style or an image or something. And, you know, it's normal, human, isn't it? You know, we're not making fun of anything. We're just sort of acknowledging the way things are, right? Everybody craving to have an image, a style, a cool, to fit in somewhere. You know, public relations is all about image, isn't it? It's all about packaging, whether it's politics or religion. And so much of politics goes on, it's all about this thing of image. What's the image? How does it look? How will that sell? And so they always work about, the new word now is what are the optics like? How would that look? Not what's the substance. No, substance, we don't give a rat's rear end about substance. What are the optics? So silly, isn't it? Superficial? But that's the way it is. And religion, now they advertising these pastors now, some of these mega churches. These pastors are cool because they got ripped jeans. They show up there with their regular kind of a shirt, and they got torn jeans. And they're standing up there preaching away like this. I'm cool. See, I'm just like you. I'm one of you now. See, I'm one of the regular guys out there. You got to listen to me. So they think that gives them some advantage from the guy who wears a suit and a tie standing behind a lectern or something like that. It's their way they want to package themselves and their image. Does it make them a better preacher? Well, I don't know. Does that mean they're less arrogant, more humble? Well, not necessarily any of that. So it goes. Symbols over substance, which is very much what image is about. But there's a lot to be learned about image. And image is important. an image that we need to have in ourselves. We need to internalize. You know what I mean by internalize? That means an image that we really see and like, and we internalize it. We just kind of digest it. It becomes ours now. This is the image we really want, and the image we really want to display. And I'm not talking fashion. That's something else. You can have a fashion image, which is fine, and that's okay. You know, even rednecks. You know, they may make fun of all the Joe College guys and all the metrosexuals and the other weirdos and the geeks and stuff out there with their styles. But, you know, rednecks got theirs too. And they got their shows too. You know, they watch the Duck Dynasties and the, you know, tearing down the trees out in the forest or the fishing or whatever the deal is, you know, and chewing on the stuff and spitting it out and whatever. And they've got their style, you know, too. And their nonconformity is they conform to every other redneck out there. So we all have it. And nothing wrong with being a certain way you want to be. You're comfortable with that. You're comfortable with your kind of clothes. Some people like cotton sweaters. Others like wool. Well, fine. I'm not really getting into any of that. I'm just letting this be a lead into the whole concept of image, which people want to gravitate toward, want to get an image, because they think that makes them belong, and they want people to see them in this light. Well, I want to take that concept and broaden it out to what the big image is, the real big image. Jesus had an image, by the way. He had an image of what he wanted to be, of who he wanted to be like. And he did everything he could to live up to that image. Apparently did a pretty good job. And do you know who his ideal was that he wanted to image in his life? Of course you do. Turn to John the 8th chapter. John 8. And verse 27. Breaking into his thought here, Jesus says to those about him, the Jews, John calls them, they did not understand that he was telling them about his Father. So Jesus said, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am the one I claim to be." Now, he's speaking almost parabolically. What do I mean by that? He's speaking like a parable. When he's lifted up, what's that mean? Well, when he's lifted up on a cross and killed. And all that comes after that. What happens after that? Well, he's dead and then he's resurrected. He says, it's not until all that happens that you're going to understand that I am who I claim to be. That is the Son of the living God and the one that was sent to open the doors to the kingdom of God to all mankind. Then you'll understand. Right now, apparently you don't. All right. Then, and that I do nothing on my own. Now, that's a surprise for a lot of people, particularly those in the Jesus-only religion, because Jesus had no part of a Jesus-only religion. Jesus was not a Christian, you know. Far be it from him. He was not a Christian. Jesus didn't follow himself, which is what Christian means. Nothing wrong with the word Christian. But Jesus was a follower of his heavenly Father. And he was teaching others to do likewise. I do nothing of my own, but I speak just what the Father has taught me. Well, how do you get taught by the Father? Well, we've got plenty of examples of that, but basically through a study of the Word, through Torah, through the instruction of God. And that's what he speaks. That was the essence of his message. So he was learning of the Father and what the Father taught him. The one who sent me is with me and has not left me alone. So I'm with God. That's who I am with. That's who I'm following. That's from whom I get my guidance. For I always do what pleases him. Oh boy, I wish I could say that. Can you say that? Can you say, I always do what pleases him? Come on now. Be truthful. I want to be able to say that. In fact, somebody was mentioning, you know, a good thing to say every morning when you get up, you roll out of the sack, and you start having your first thoughts of the morning. Let one of those very first thoughts be, what can I do today to please my Father in heaven? What can I do? That's a good thought, isn't it? Might that help you in your direction of your day, which way you go? I think so. For I always do what pleases him. So Jesus says, not my will, but it's the Father's will that counts. He's my leader. Even as he spoke, many put their faith in him. So he was leading people to his heavenly Father. That was his image. That's where he was getting his information and getting his inspiration as well. We won't turn there, but in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, it speaks about the priesthood and about the law that casts a shadow of good things. And, you know, an image casts a shadow. And the law, in this case, was the image. It casts a shadow. Now, the shadow is not the image. The image casts a shadow. The image is the real thing. And when we're made in the image of God, that is the real thing. And when Jesus had internalized the divine nature, it became like his heavenly Father. Remember, he was so much like his Father. He said, look, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, because we're one. We're one. That's how close he was. So he had truly internalized the very nature of his heavenly Father. That didn't happen at once, my friends. It doesn't happen to you at once. It won't happen to me at once. It takes a while. It takes learning. It takes teaching. He says, I speak just what the Father has taught me. Now that teaching was through Torah. That's what Torah means. It means instruction. Instruction from God. And that's how he learned. You say, well, no, Jesus knew all that. Did he? Where do you find that he knew it all? That he's born as a baby and he just sort of knew it all. Turn to the book of Luke. Luke, the second chapter. To a Passover event. Now, his parents were good parents. Mary and Joseph, excellent parents. Chosen by God. Boy, I tell you, couldn't get any better parents than that. Chosen by God. And why did he choose them? You know, because they were going to be the ones teaching and training Jesus. And so they did a lot of good things, a lot of right things. One of them was they took him up to Jerusalem at the Passover. That wasn't a bad thing. It was a good thing. How many parents today teach their kids about the Passover? Well, not too many. They teach them about Easter and Christmas and Halloween and blah, 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 and all the kind of other stuff, but that, you know, they don't find any of that in the Bible. But how about the Passover? That was a good place to do some teaching, wasn't it? So he's up there, and after the Passover was over, verse 46 of Luke 2, After 3 days, they found him in the temple court, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. So these were the teachers of the law. These were the scribes. These were the experts in the law that had given their whole lives to the study of the law. Didn't mean they were perfect, but that was their expertise. They could teach a lot. There's a lot to be learned from them. And Jesus listened to them as they were expounding from the law and asking them questions. Sometimes I'm sure some of those questions were challenging questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. Apparently, they asked him questions, and he answered. So it was in the typical Socratic style, you know, the Socrates style of question and answer. And this is the way rabbinical teaching's always been. A lot of discussion, a lot of question and answer, even debate. That's how you learn. And Jesus was in that kind of environment at 12 years of age. His parents put him in that environment. They didn't expect him to be hanging around there. Not at all. In fact, they were kind of, you know, put out. When his parents, they'd been looking for him, as you see the previous part of the story, and he wasn't with them, and they were all upset and everything else. And it says, and when his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father, Joseph, and I have been anxiously searching for you." No doubt they were in absolute panic for 3 days searching for their son. Where is he? Now, they'd given an awful lot of freedom, obviously. They thought he was somewhere in the entourage of other pilgrims, other faithful, other families that they knew who were traveling to Jerusalem for the Passover season. And so they were looking for him and didn't see him. They just assumed that he was with the rest of them as they were walking back up to Nazareth. But he wasn't there. Couldn't find him anywhere. They were panicked, so they go rushing back to Jerusalem. Can you imagine Mary and Joseph here? Their foreheads are furrowed with anguish and everything else. And they see Jesus calmly sitting in the middle of this august group of scholars, apparently enjoying himself, having, you know, a good discussion, learning. What did Jesus say later on there? We're reading in John 8, things he learned. Well, that's how some of this learning was taking place. And Jesus said, "Why were you searching for me?" he said. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" Or some translations have it, "about my father's business." Didn't you know that? Now, they should have, but they were used to the regular routine of every day, and they had kind of forgotten some of these things. And they kind of forgotten the special calling that he had. And he has to remind them that he has a duty, he has a job, and part of the image that he has in his own mind is to learn all he can about his heavenly father. That's his job. That's what he wants to do, because he wants to do everything to please him. Is there anything more important than to learn about God and what God's like? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. But they did not understand what he was saying to them. It kind of, some of this passed over them. 12 years old, telling us this. They're just amazed. So he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. Yeah, he was still 12, so, you know, he did his chores, did his things, whatever else he needed to do. He had four brothers, he had sisters. So there's a family of about eight children, plus Joseph and Mary. It was a pretty big household. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. She filed them away, pondered them, thought about them. Later on, of course, it became very evident what was going on. And notice it says, and Jesus grew in wisdom. It's something that grows in you. It doesn't have it automatically. And stature. And in favor with God and men. So, how was he becoming more favorable in the eyes of God? Because he was doing God's will. He was drawn close to God. And how about with men? Well, because he was obedient and was a good son, a real good son. My wife's name is Goodson. I always like that name, a good son. Romans, the 12th chapter, it's one of your memory verses, right? You already got this one memorized. I know Crystal does. Don't you? Romans 12:1. Crystal, you probably got this memorized. I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. In other words, this is the epitome of worship, is to give yourself to God, offer yourself to God. It isn't stand up, wave an arm, jumping up and down, hoopla and all. Or people think that's a worship service. No, true worship is giving yourself to God. Worship is what worship means, giving full worth to God. And the highest honor you can pay God is to want to become like him, to mimic him, to try to imitate him. It's like Paul said, become imitators of me as I imitate Jesus. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of the world, you know, with all of its images and everything else. Don't conform to all those images. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good will, his pleasing will, his perfect will for you. This is what God wants each of us to do, is take on this divine image. And it's put in plain words here in Peter. Let's go to 2 Peter 1 and verse 4. Peter doesn't mince. You may say, well, why is God concerned with me? I'm just a little nobody here. You're talking about taking on the divine image of God, and that God is busy with me. I can see where he'd be busy with Jesus, but how about me? Why would he waste any time with me? I'm a nobody. Well, I'll tell you why. There's a secret to it. 2 Peter 1 and verse 4. Speaking of God's calling through the knowledge of God, his divine power is given to everything, given us everything we need. Verse 3. Everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him. So everything you need for life and godliness can be found in the root of the knowledge of him, of God. That's why the knowledge of God is so critical. That's where you're going to get the guidance for life, the guidance for godliness. Who called us by his own glory and goodness. You know, all of his power, all of his goodness. And he called you. Why you? Does he know your name? Of course he does. The other week I was reading the scriptures there, John 6:44, John 6:65, where Jesus said, nobody comes unto the Son except the Father drawing him first. So the Father knows the ones he's going to call, and he calls them, and he picks them. And he knows who he wants to pick, and he picks by categories, generally. And what category are you? Well, let's see. And though he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them we may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. This divine nature, read divine image. That is the ideal, that you're made in the image of God to have His nature, His divine nature. And that's what Jesus had, the divine nature. You know, how did He get it? Well, He explained how He got it. Learning of God, drawing near to Him, trying to please Him, following His words and not His own, doing God's will, not His own. And how did He become? Well, He became then the right hand of the most powerful being in the cosmos, the creator of everything. It doesn't mean He became a nobody. He became a somebody by deciding every day what He could do to please His Heavenly Father. You say, well, why little old you? I'm a nobody, lost in a crowd, I'm not important. Well, He's chosen you to be an image bearer, to cast a shadow wherever you are. And that's an image you want to cultivate, you want to internalize, you want to develop, you want to polish and shine to make sure it is truly an image of the divine nature, not some other direction. Let's close by turning to 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. And I'll tell you the categories that God likes to deal with as far as calling people. Now, this is not an ironclad rule. He'll call others. But as a general thing, this is how it works and explains a lot. That He's called people not based on their IQ or their credentials or their money or their place in society or their big houses or their big cars or their big wallets or their big hairdos or anything else. He calls them based on what? On His own judgment, on His own mercy. He looks down at the heart, at people, and He decides to call certain ones. And I think He does it with a smile on His face. And here we get a little insight in that in chapter 1 of 1 Corinthians, where He says in verse 18, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate." Where's the wise man? Where's the scholar? Where's the philosopher of the age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? All these smarty pants people out there who think they know everything, come up with the theories of evolution, fill up all the professorships of all the universities, and gee, they're just so smart and they can look down the nose at everybody else and pile degrees after their name, and they're just so smart. Is God impressed by any of that? And have they found the way to peace? How about the smart people running our government right now? Well, they can't even make a healthcare program run. They can't even get people to dial up on the internet. This is smart. "For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know Him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached," foolishness in quotes, that they call it foolishness. He didn't call it foolishness. People call it foolishness. Religion, foolishness. Superstition, blah, blah. But through that, to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs. The Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach history, Christ crucified, facts, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who God has called, Christ the power of God, the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, So even, quote, foolishness, unquote, that you say God has, is so much wiser than anything man can come up with. And the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. And of course, there is no weakness in God. But people would say, well, that's weak. And people would say the Christians he chooses are weak. Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Okay, see if this fits you, my friend. It fits me. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were noble birth. No, that's me. I wasn't any of those things. But God chose the foolish, again in quotes. Things of the world to shame the wise, the off-scouring, or the ignored, the inconsequential, the nobodies, the dumb sheep, the masses, you know, as the elite would look down on us. And God's chosen them to confound the wise. Think God's smiling over that? I think he likes it. I think he likes doing business that way. He's going to humble the earth, and that's one way in which he can do it. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things, or the weak ones of the world, to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not, like, you know, you don't exist, to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. There's one of the reasons. This ties into my favorite scripture in all the Bible, Jeremiah 9. Well, you know, men boast about some things. The only thing you can really ever boast about is that you know God and what he is like. It is because of him that you are in Christ, who has become the wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, it's our holiness, our redemption. Therefore it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. That's a quote from Jeremiah, God. So God has decided to choose you and me and regular, everyday kind of people out there and invest in us the precious truth, the pearls of great wisdom. His wisdom, the very wisdom that Jesus gained, and the very wisdom that Jesus has become in us, so that we be the image bearers of God. And you know what he's going to do? He's going to use us to teach the world what true wisdom is. Now, is that a good thing? I think God thinks it's a very good thing. I think he likes it. That's what he said. He's going to use us to confound the world. He's going to take people that the world has looked over that don't really matter and aren't consequential at all, and he's going to use them to teach the world about God. Now, what do you think of that? I think that's a very good program. I think there's an irony to it. There's a humility that's going to be gained from it. And there's also a fairness to it. That those who are riding high and mighty in this world and everything else, most of them are not much concerned about God anyway, are they? But those of us that he has called, don't say to yourself, why me? I'm nobody. Surely not. God doesn't care about me. Look, he does. Jesus said, hey, if he wants to know how many hairs you got hanging off your head, he knows. He knows everything about you. And he loves you. And he's molding you into his divine nature. Let him make you in his image. That's what he's doing. That's what he wants to do. That's what he did with Jesus. And that's what Jesus and the Father are now busily doing with all those in his church. So we can be thankful that God has given us an image to live up to. An image that casts a shadow that reflects God to others. And that's the image we should bear. Okay, well, that concludes our time today, and we're going to close with a song, It Is No Secret, and What a Wonderful World. And I've got my granddaughter Megan here. Megan, you want to come up and say hi to everybody? You don't? Okay, well, that's fine. Crystal, you want to come up and say hi to everybody?
I'll say hi.
Okay.
I want
to see Mia. Yeah, this is
hi.
This is Crystal here.
Hi. I'm Zena.
I'll get a little wider. There you go. Yeah, she's the adopted sister of our granddaughter Megan over here. So,
do we look alike?
Huh?
Do we look alike? Do we look alike?
Not too much, but anyway.
I'm darker.
Darker than what?
Anyway, it's good to have both you girls here. Thank you. Well, it's going to be Anne Murray singing to us. It Is No Secret. Some of you like Anne Murray. I certainly do.
At least it's not Elvis.
At least it's not Elvis. Well, a lot of people out there like Elvis, granddaughter. Some don't. I understand that. Music is kind of like food. Some have a taste for certain kinds. Some have a taste for others. You can't please everybody, right? Well, thanks for joining us today, and let's ask God's dismissal. Loving Father in heaven, thank you for calling us into your family to be image bearers of you. What a privilege. What an honor. What a glorious thing to be entrusted with the precious gift of bearing your image, bearing your name. Help us, Father, to be worthy, to take it seriously, to each day ask what we can do to please you and follow in the footsteps of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We ask your dismissal now and your blessing, your healing upon those who need your healing touch and your comfort and protection. We ask your dismissal in Jesus' name. Amen. See you next week.
The chimes of time ring out the news, another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you? You may have longed for added strength, your courage to renew. Not be disheartened, for I have news for you. It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do for you. Wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. There is no night, for in His light you'll never walk alone. Always feel at home. wherever you may roam. There is no power can conquer you while God is on your side. Take him at his promise. Don't run away and hide. It is no secret what God can do, what he's done for others, he'll do for you. No secret what God can do. It is no secret what God can do.
Think to myself,